Hello and welcome back to another episode of Critical Reactions with your host Brian. We are going to continue on with this week's theme of jazz with unusual instruments, looking at the band's Weather Report and the title track of the album Black Market. The title's called Black Market. Let's dive into this and see what Weather Report is bringing to the table today. A synthesizer is really interesting, and there's a lot of points for personal inflection on it, for expressionistic playing. So a bar 4/4 and a bar 7/8. Oh, then they tricked me on the last one. Okay. Yeah. Oh. That bass line. Dude, the rhythm section's going off. Mm-hmm. What was that? Oh, for a second there, I forgot I was recording a reaction. I was just going to my normal mode. Oh, I have questions. Let's go research some stuff. No, I need to be talking. Like that's why people show up here. I mean, we start and end with environmental sounds. It sounds like people moving, having conversations, little sounds, and kind of does remind me of being in a market square. And the noise gets busier and busier, and then we shift away from the, well, the environmental sounds to something a bit more abstract. And we represent the market through music. But then by the end of it, we quiet it down. And I honestly thought by this point, hey, you know, I get the point of this story. It's you know, I'm getting a metaphor here. It's quieting down. The market's wrapping up. You know, the customers and the people at market that are selling their services and products there, they're all getting ready to go home for the night, and the market will reopen tomorrow. But then we hear bombs and gunfire, heavily compressed and muted in a way that makes them sound like they're far off in the distance, not just with volume, but also manipulating the sounds to sound distant. And so it's got to be some sort of empathetic song, showcasing the joys and positivity and just overall brightness to this market and possibly to the people and culture as well, and kind of reminding you that there's humanity here despite the war going on. And I don't know what war this would be. I don't know. I gotta look this up right now. Something tells me is it might be something to do with competing forces in Africa. But I am not. So I did a Wikipedia search for black market, and I completely forgot that that is a term for like underground shops to buy stuff of varying legality. I was like, what is all of this? Oh, there's a record label called Black Market Music. Interesting. There's a Rise Against album called Black Market. Weather Report. There we go. There's also a Rick Ross album. This is a popular name for music. And there's nothing here about it either. Y'all are going to have to let me know if you know what the purpose of this song is, what it might be specifically talking about. I mean, this was 76, and I'm trying to remember any big moments in 76 that would have been in Africa, and I'm drawing a blank there. Holy cannoli. So, you remember the bass blew me away, right? A couple of times, both in its tone, the bass lines, and then just those really sick licks during the solo section. Yeah, it's Jaco Pastorius, of course. That dude's just a beast on guitar, I mean on bass, and yeah, really blown away there. But also we had Cannonball Adderley on saxophone, but not on this track. It was actually on the following track called Cannonball, but I'm kind of interested in that now. Because Adderley is a disgusting saxophonist. Oh, actually, it's not. It's a tribute to Adderley because Adderley had passed away a few months before this album was recorded. Well, that's. That's a bit of a downer. All right, let's get to talking about the album itself now, right? I mean, the track itself. So, we had two sets of interesting instruments for this one, since that is the theme of the week. First of all, we had a lot of hand drums that kind of brought a sort of a tribal element to the percussive section. The percussion section was just, I mean, it was electric, full of energy, energizing, just tons of movement and ideas and overlapping rhythmic concepts that almost felt too much at times and could have erred into chaos if not for careful composition. It was just so well done. So many layers, so many elements. And the thing is too, something I don't think a lot of people think about is that it's not just a lot of drums. Each of the drums has their own specific pitch and timbre, and they can be manipulated, especially with hand drums, about where you hit it, how you hit it. There's so many different ways to get different tones and textures out of a lot of hand drums that it's not just creating rhythmic components, it's creating a full sonic palette, basically. And it adds so much to music when you get outside of snare, tom, and cymbals. And, like, the drum kit is prolific for a reason. It is exceptionally versatile. But I really enjoy when bands go outside the general conventions for percussion. I mean, the same thing is true with everything. It all comes down to convention. You know, I like rock, but sometimes I don't want just guitars and vocals and drums, you know. So, I mean, I suppose that's the same thing here. I'm saying, you know, other bands should use drums outside of the drum kit. I mean, no, that's not accurate. But I do think that it brings a richness to the percussive section that is just underutilized in a lot of modern music. And I really appreciate it here. Having this very rich palette coming from the percussion section. But, you know, it's not just the percussion in the rhythm section. We also have the piano, which might be a keyboard or a synthesizer, I'm not quite sure. We have a very traditional piano sound here, but then we also have a lot of other textures and timbres coming from something that sounds like it's probably a piano instrument, which makes me think of keyboard or synthesizer, where the sound is just a little off from a traditional piano. So anyways, we have some really cool piano lines going on here, and the way that they dance around things rhythmically in, counter rhythm to what the percussion is doing. It's just kind of really interesting in like the funkiest kind of ways. But then we also have the bass coming in and playing off of all of that. And the bass is just, I mean, it's Jaco. So, you know, it goes without saying, but the bass is sick in a lot of these sections, and it is so clean, especially when we get those fast eighth note triplets and the pockets of 3 or 4 16th notes that we use to lead into downbeats. Like, it is just crisp playing. But then we also just have like a bunch of moments where the whole rhythm section is just playing off of each other in the funnest ways, and I feel kind of bad about it, because the rhythm section totally overshone the, was it a sax that did the solo? Do we have a saxophonist here? Here we go. We do have a grand piano on this track, but we also have an electric piano and two polyphonic synthesizers, the ARP2600. So we do have a soprano and a tenor sax. I'm pretty sure the tenor is what we heard here. And a lyricon? What is a lyricon? What in the world is... You guys gotta see this. It's like a reeded flute? that's connected to something digital. And it's almost like a woodwind synthesizer is what it looks like. Was this, I shook way too hard, the whole screen shook. Was this in the song? Because there were a couple of things in there I wasn't 100% sure about. And this would certainly be an unusual instrument for jazz, kind of, right? Because the keys look like clarinet. And it is reeded, like a clarinet would be, but it is in itself, the clarinet is a jazz instrument, but the lyricon is not, even if it is just, if we could break it down and be completely reductive, an electronic clarinet of sorts. I've never heard jazz with a lyricon, so I'm kind of curious if that was in this track or not. Bonkers. But we did have the saxophones, and I'm pretty sure we heard the saxophone. There are two bassists in here. Oh, Jaco wasn't on this one. So this bassist was Alfonso Johnson. So Alfonso, all the praise I have for the bass that I was attributing to Jaco is now yours, Alfonso. I've never heard you before, I don't think, but I'm listening now. Kind of curious what else it's played on. Because that was some sick... Oh, he's played with Santana. Oh my god, all throughout the 80s, beginning of the 90s. He's played with Chet Baker, Phil Collins. Okay, so he's somebody. I don't know how I've never heard his name before. Where was I going before I took this huge deep dive? Oh yeah, I feel bad for the saxophonist during the solo section, because it was a good solo, but the rhythm section just took the spotlight. There's just no way around it. The rhythm section was disgusting there, and there was no way not to listen to them. And even I think the engineer knew that and bumped their volume up a bit higher than the sax. The sax was so quiet there. I don't know. It felt kind of weird, but yeah, the soloist was not the spotlight of the solo section. Dang, what else do I gotta say about this? Funky riffs, all over the place. Super catchy in a lot of places. And I love the overarching story of this thing, right? I kind of talked about how it tells a story within itself, utilizing the environmental sounds on the outsides of it. And the dynamics as well. I don't know if you're watching the little volume guy over there, but there is a lot of volume range here between our quietest and loudest parts. And it creates a song that feels alive in a couple ways. Then we also have just the richness and diversity of our sonic palette and just the fantastic production of everything. Everything is clear and crisp. Nothing is muddy. And honestly, you know, if I closed my eyes and didn't know, I mean, I'd be able to feel the headphones or whatever, but you know, this is pretty close to a live recording. It has that electricity of being right there listening to the music. It has the cleanliness of sound of that too. And I'm a huge fan of that. I really am. And I was talking about this at the beginning too. Another richness to it is the emotiveness of the synthesizer, I think. And I don't know if that's because they have dials or whatever, allowing them to have fine-tuned modular control over the pitch. In fact, what I might be talking about is the Lyricon, for all I know. And that had a lot of dials on it to control specific sounds. But the end result was a very expressive performance from that instrument that felt very much like any other non-digital instrument, and having fine-tuned air control or embouchure muscles or the way that you pick the guitar or slides or, you know, anything that gives you that extra expressiveness. And that's what I kind of walk away with this one, is that it feels live and it feels like expressive performance. And the two of them together just comes along into a song that is a joy to listen to from start to finish. Well, except the finish isn't very joyful. It's kind of shocked a little bit at the end there. And so I guess it's a good way to segue this into my outro. Those are my thoughts on, I've gone so many pages away. What is this? Weather Report's Black Market. What did you think on this? Did you enjoy it? Was there anything that stood out to you? Do you have information about the story here that they're telling? That was my segue. and what it's about. It pulls in so many interesting influences, but the story itself is undeniable. And I'm just not sure what it's specifically referring to. Above the comment section is a description box. In there is a link for Linktree. In here you can find a link to my music, ways to support the channel, a link to the Discord server, and so much more. Go ahead and check that out. Above that, if you could, like, subscribe, and ring the bell. I greatly appreciate all three of those. We have a special selection coming up next. Otherwise, check you guys tomorrow, 5 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, 9 p.m. UTC, as usual. Until next time, remember to be critical, not cynical, of the music you listen to, and have a fantastic morning, afternoon, or evening, whenever you choose to watch my videos.